pretty close to the music, and I have the right glasses on, so I'm pretty good, I think.
Well, next is Braille.
Oh, gosh.
Piano, piano and music Braille like this.
Oh, but you know, I have like a few times in the last week, it's almost like my vision. But my vision, sometimes I used to see like spots or something.
Those are called ghosts?
No. No. Is that what it is?
Because I have them in my right eye.
Are you seeing things? Apparitions or something?
No. No.
You sure?
Yeah.
Just floaters.
Just asking. Is that hallucinatory medicine?
Okay. I'll say, let the weak say I'm strong. Let the poor say I'm rich.
Drink more vodka.
No, I had a hard time sleeping last night, and then when I finally went back to sleep real early in the morning, and then my clock went off, it was hard to get up. Sort of out of my routine. I just can't get up a normal time since I had that tooth done, really. Just most days I just can't.
Do you sleep a lot? Are you in bed most of the day?
No. I mean, if I really get fatigued, you know, in the afternoon I'll lay down. But, and then I've still got that dermatitis and that itching, so sometimes I have to take something at night because the itching bothers me. And of course, it does make me sleep good. That stronger stuff the doctor gave me, but it's aggravating. I guess you could say I'm retired of me. I have plenty to do, but it's just like I just haven't. I haven't had the strength the last month or so to do it though. I think my body was just so tired of fighting off all that stuff I had, you know, because I was on prednisone twice, antibiotic twice.
That's not good.
Yeah, so, well, you know, the devil does his best. When physically you don't have as much strength, it's harder to sing.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our 9 o'clock service here at Asbury United Methodist Church. Doug will be doing the announcements this morning, but there's one thing that I'd like to share with you. We started a visioning process, the first meeting we had was yesterday. And how it works is, do you have a slide, Jennifer? And I'll explain this as we go through, but it's it's something, a process that's just, it's continuous, it goes on and on. And the name of it is called Discover Asbury. You know, after this pandemic, there's been so many changes, not only in the way we worship, but in the way we live. So we wanted to go through and do a little assessment of our values and make sure that our vision and mission was all in harmony with that. The first step in it is called discovery, and it's invite the church members to attend a in-person and Zoom meeting so that we can identify what our core values are here at Asbury and make sure that they're in harmony with our mission and vision. So yesterday we had around 8 people that joined us, and we started the process yesterday. But this is an invitation. We really want to see as many people who attend Asbury to join us in identifying what our core values are. The second step in it is assessing the needs of the church body here and the community, and making sure that that we're capable, based on our core values, of delivering on the needs that the church body has and the community. The third step in it is called alignment. That's aligning the vision and mission for harmony with core values, developing goals and strategies from the identified needs to ensure that we have alignment with vision and mission. And last but not least is just measuring our success. Are we really achieving those? And it's just an ongoing cycle that we'll continue to go through. So there are 6 groups, 3 that meet by Zoom and 3 that are meeting in person here in Fellowship Hall. And the dates of those were sent out in the Asbury agenda. So we would just love to invite you to attend so that you could help us identify what our core values are. And then we'll be reaching out to figure out what the needs are in the church body and in the community. So if you have any questions, I'll be around later. I'll be glad to answer them for you. Thank you.
I don't need it. I got my own. Thank you. And before Doug starts the worship service officially, I know that it's been kind of a chaotic week as far as the CDC and regulations, and the governor says that this Friday there's no longer a mask mandate, and everybody's going, yes, and they're thinking that maybe we're just going to just throw off all the masks and just move forward. But we're going to take a moment. We're going to take a breath this week to kind of sit back and kind of see what the most faithful response for us as a church family is. So we're not going to say that you can just walk in next Sunday without a mask if you've been vaccinated. We're going to sit down and really put some serious thought into it and some prayer. So hopefully by Friday we'll have figured that out. But I just didn't want anybody to make assumptions, because we are still going to have unvaccinated people in this building. We're still going to have our children who are unable to get vaccinations. And so we have to take all of that into account. So I'm just kind of giving you the heads up to be looking for how we decide to move forward by Friday. Hopefully we'll have that figured out by then, but it takes more than just one person making that decision, and it kind of happens so fast that we just really haven't had time to assess it. So we're gonna take that time this week. So thank you for your patience, and it doesn't take effect till Friday, so we're hoping that we'll have it figured out by then. And I'm gonna call up Doug.
Good morning again. I'm Doug Covert, and I'm your worship leader this morning for the 9 a.m. contemporary service here at Asbury United Methodist Church in Smyrna, Delaware. We're glad that you have joined us, either here in person or via the internet, Facebook, or YouTube. All of you are warmly welcomed. Yesterday was Armed Forces Day, so to all of our active duty military and our veterans, a sincere and heartfelt thank you for all that you have done, are doing, and will continue to do as you serve and keep us safe. God bless you all. We do have a couple other announcements this morning. Today's offering, please place it in the plate by the door as you leave. There's a basket there for the second Sunday offering, and this month that is for the Camp Pocomath Scholarships. Pocomath is a Methodist camp in Centerville, Maryland, which provides Christian enrichment and camping experiences for youth during the summer. Every Asbury youth interested in camp is assisted as needed to be able to attend. Funds not used by our youth will be donated to the camp for the Spain grant scholarships. That enables students of limited means to attend at no cost to them. The blue basket by the door is for these donations, or you can mail them into the office. Just please mark it second Sunday. After the May issue, we will only mail a paper newsletter to those people that formally request it from the church office, either by email or a phone call. Otherwise, the newsletter will be emailed along with the Asbury agenda each week. On Memorial Day weekend, we will hold the 9 a.m. service outside at the Glenwood lot. Starting in June, we plan to have an outdoor worship the third Sunday of each month, weather permitting. The 11 o'clock service will continue to be held in the sanctuary. And now let us pray. Wonderful God, we gather together today to worship and to thank you for the many blessings that you have showered upon us. We are often so busy that we don't recognize them, or sometimes even take the time to say thank you. Please forgive us, Lord, and prepare us to receive that special message that you have for each one of us today. May we keep it in our hearts and on our minds as we go through this week. We thank you, Lord. We love you and we trust you. And all God's people say, amen. And as soon as I get the mic over there, the praise band will be singing Everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our home, our strong deliverer.
Woohoo, amen. So, a couple things to pray for. George Wicks passed away this past Friday, so please be in prayer for that family. We don't know quite the arrangements yet. It'll be Friday night and Saturday sometime, but we don't know those yet, but we'll send them out when we know. Charlotte Kermes, I saw her yesterday, and she is wanting to go home, and she's going to go physically home on Monday or Tuesday, so hopefully after that she'll be able to receive visitors. So, but the end is near, so please be in prayer for all of them. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Holy God, we know that at these times of transitions, that it can be so painful for those who remain. So Lord, we ask for your peace. And we get that peace, Lord, from the joy of knowing that we have eternal life in you and that this is not the end. Death does not have victory, but you have the victory. Lord, we thank you for the lives of those that have come to you this past month, as there have been more than a few. So Lord, we just ask that you wrap this whole congregation in your love as they are missing those that have gone to be with you, and as we anticipate another transition. Lord, we lift up all of the concerns that are on our hearts, as we know that there are many. This nation is in turmoil. So many things going on with gas shortages and hoarding and hackers and people being frustrated and angry over so many things. Lord, this pandemic has brought a lot of chaos and confusion, and Lord, we just need you in the midst of all of this. So Lord, give us strength. Give us your peace. Give us your confidence and the courage to face each new day, knowing that you are in control. And if you are for us, who can be against us? Lord, we lift all of this up and more in the name of your precious son, Jesus. Amen. And today we have a special day. I don't think we got to do this. We were outside last year, if I recall, but graduation Sunday, we're going to recognize our graduates. So if our scholarship chair could come up, and we will call up our graduates. Yep, sorry.
Good morning. I'm here on behalf of the scholarship committee, and we have one scholarship recipient this year from the high school. Teresa, if you could come up, please. So Teresa Pena, I know, has been a really great asset to Asbury. As an outsider, I know that I could see her working here all the time with the youth. And with Michelle, and she's always here helping out at the church. So she is a really great recipient for the Asbury Youth Scholarship. So I'd like to say congratulations to Teresa. I understand you're going to be going to Grand Canyon University online. And do you know what you're going to be studying?
Early childhood education and special education.
She said early childhood education and special education, which, you know, that warms my heart. So congratulations. And we have a certificate for you, and we're going to send this check for you to Grand Canyon University.
We need to acknowledge all of our graduates. We have two other graduates, and that we have Sean McCracken Jr., Shawnee, and Kaylin Wilson. Come on up, Michelle. You can be here on her behalf. Come on over here. We will bite. Tell the world where you graduated from.
Okay, my name is Sean McCracken. I just graduated from Delaware Technical Community College in the Culinary Arts program.
And he's cooking lunch. And we'll leave this to you. I have a gift for you.
And Kaylin graduated with her associates in education, elementary ed.
All right, that's
she's
a Dell Tech too, right?
To Wilmia.
Uh-huh. All right, and you can give that to her for me. And we already know what Teresa's doing. So thank you guys, good work. We love you. And we are praying that God blesses your future. Thank you so much. Oh, wait a minute, Teresa, stay here. And thank you to the scholarship committee for doing their work. We appreciate all you do. God bless. Let's sing.
I dreamed I went to heaven. You were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing and someone called your name. You turned and saw the young man. He was smiled as he came.
And he said, friend, you may not know me now. Then he said, but wait, you used to teach my Sunday school when I was only eight. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave.
Another man stood before you.
He said, remember the time missionary came to your church. Your picture made me cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it all away. Jesus took the gift you gave. That's why I'm here today. For giving to the Lord, I am a life that has changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave.
One by one they came
as far as eyes could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things you've done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaim.
I know up in heaven, you're not supposed to cry. I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward.
Thank you for giving to the Lord.
Giving to the Lord, I am so glad.
so glad you came.
Amen. We could say that to many of the people here in this room as well. What a blessing it is when we serve God together, and how many lives do get changed by things we don't even recognize that we do. So good morning, Asbury. So good to be with you this morning. We are in the Gospel of Luke, Luke 24, verses 44 to 53. This is the last Sunday of the Easter season, for those that don't know that. That's why everything was still white in the sanctuary. So, listen to the word of the Lord. Then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. The word of God for the people of God. Now, May 13th was Ascension Day. Jesus is taken up into heaven 40 days after the resurrection, or what we call Easter morning. And our Apostles' Creed reminds us that we believe on the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And it goes on to say he will come again to judge the living and the dead. And as people of faith in Jesus Christ, our Savior, the Messiah, these are important statements of our faith. See, we often speak about God's grace given to us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and certainly that is true. However, we tend to downplay or gloss over the ongoing grace poured out on our lives that comes through his ascension. Although the birth of Jesus, God coming to us in the flesh, is a monumental moment, it is really only a part of God's entire plan of salvation. Every act of God seen in Jesus is an important piece of God's ongoing story of redemption, and his ascension is no less important than his life, death, and resurrection. And as a matter of fact, I believe that coupled with Pentecost, which we'll celebrate next week when we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, Jesus' ascension is the act that holds the most influence and impact for us as believers today. So, what are those implications of Jesus' ascension? Christ being lifted up into heaven in front of his apostles, and how is that important to us today? Well, first, let's just look at the passages about his ascension. You see, there's really not a lot written about it. It seems almost like a side note. Matthew and John don't mention it at all. Mark only mentions it if you read the long ending that was supposedly added on much later after the original gospel was written. And it says, "So then the Lord Jesus, after he had spoken to them, was taken up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and proclaimed the good news everywhere, while the Lord worked with them and confirmed the message by the signs that accompanied it." Now, Luke's account we read just a minute ago, but Luke is also the writer of Acts, which tells the ascension story again in much more detail. So in Acts 1, 6 through 11, "So when they had come together, they asked him, 'Lord, is this the time you will restore the kingdom to Israel?' And he replied, 'It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why are you standing there looking up toward heaven? This is Jesus, and this Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Now, there's lots of imagery in this description, and I don't know about you, but it's easy for me to get a picture of Superman with one arm raised to the sky, just lifting off the earth and disappearing from sight. Look, up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Jesus ascending to heaven. But this is an important moment, one that fulfills scripture that Luke has been sure to talk about all throughout his gospel. And in Luke's account, Jesus is seen explaining over and over how the writings of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms, every little detail of God's plan of redemption and salvation is written about and fulfilled in him. He explains it to the pilgrims on the way to Emmaus and to the disciples and his appearances after the resurrection. And if you look back, he talks about those scriptures all throughout his ministry. This is God's plan. He's been telling it to you all along. See me, hear me, touch me, and know that I am the Messiah, the one foretold by scripture. Watch as you see the evidence of the truth. Know that I am the fulfillment of God's plan, God's promise of redemption and eternal life. And because you can see that everything God has promised has happened just like he said it would, you can have assurance that the future will unfold in the same way, just as God has promised. Without the ascension, we could not have that assurance at all. This one moment in time in the history of our salvation holds the key to our future, as it boldly proclaims the truth of our past, that God's plan remains true, and that Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of those plans, past, present, and future. But why is the truth about the ascension key to our life of faith today? What does it matter for you and for me, or even our brothers and sisters around the world who believe in Jesus as the Messiah? Well, all along, Jesus told the disciples everything that was written about him in the scriptures, giving them clues about what would happen. "You are witnesses of these things," he says. But technically, they didn't witness those other key events. No one was there at his birth. They did walk with him for 3 years, but they didn't even witness his baptism. Only John the Baptist and his followers were there. They witnessed some of his miracles, but they did not see him crucified or buried or resurrected. Jesus has opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and they do, but they didn't see those events in person. So how are they witnesses? Well, because he is standing before them now, the culmination of all the prophecies and the proof of God's faithfulness in carrying out his plan. It is important to the future of God's plan that they know this truth, so they can continue his work throughout the world when he is physically gone from them. When Jesus began his ministry, he said, "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." This is the same message he calls his disciples to spread throughout the earth, beginning in Jerusalem. A message of repentance and forgiveness of sins proclaimed in the name of Jesus Christ. And as he prepares to leave them, he gives them what they need to continue that work. God's plan of salvation and redemption for the world is an ongoing story that began with Jesus and continues with his disciples, moving forward through time, including all of his followers, including you and including me. As he comes to the day of ascension, the disciples must be prepared to continue that work without him there in the flesh. He has supplied everything they need so far, instructions, an example to follow, and all they need to fully believe the truth about who he is and why he came. Now he's going to give them the final resources they will need to continue that work. becoming the means God will use to fulfill his promise of a glorious future in the world. Well, the first thing he does is solidify their faith by making them true witnesses. They might not have seen all those other events in the salvation story, but like his birth and death and resurrection, but they certainly have come to believe all that is true. But they haven't really been witnesses. So after opening up the scriptures once again, he lets them see his ascension. They are there. They see him lifted up into heaven, the final proof that he is indeed the Messiah foretold in scripture. So finally, they are true witnesses in every sense of the word. And because they are witnesses, we have come to believe. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. But the second thing is even more important than the first. Matthew does not talk about the ascension, but he does give us the Great Commission, our ongoing mission in the church. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. In our passage today, Jesus tells them to proclaim the message of repentance and the forgiveness of sins in his name. This is the message of salvation. Repent and receive the forgiveness given to us in the name of Jesus. This is the message that will change hearts, that will change the world and bring God's kingdom on earth. This is the message that brings salvation, new life, and restores creation to what God intended. This is the message that points us in the direction of that new Jerusalem, the second coming of Christ that ushers in a world where there is no more suffering, no more pain, and no more death. And we needed Christ to ascend to heaven in order to have what we need to fulfill that mission. He tells them and us in John 16, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. Although he ascends into heaven, he is always with us through the power of the Holy Spirit. And the Spirit gives us power, connects us to God and to one another as we continue the work of Christ in the world. We are the church, the body, and the bride of Christ. Jesus returns to heaven to sit at the right hand of God the Father. And it is because he leaves his earthly existence that we are able to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is crucial to our life of faith until Christ comes again. It is because he now sits in heaven that we have an intercessor, one who makes us holy and righteous before God. Think about it. There is a battle being waged in this world, a battle for the souls of every human being. In our baptism, we are given the Holy Spirit that marks us as God's children, gives us the power to resist evil, that through the work of Christ on the cross takes away our sin, and through the resurrection gives us eternal life. As we become God's children, Jesus' hands and feet in the world, we are fighting against the ruler of this world as we spread the good news of salvation, as we witness to that salvation in our own lives through the power of the Holy Spirit, Christ's presence living in us. And without the ascension, we would not have access to that power. Without the ascension, we would not have Christ in heaven interceding for us each and every moment, sitting at the right hand of God on our behalf, giving us salvation. Without the ascension, we would not have become part of God's salvation plan for the world. Before we know Jesus, our lives are essentially meaningless, just living day to day, trying to make sense out of why we are here. And before we repent and put our faith in Jesus, sin is the ruler of our lives. And we are living for ourselves, not part of anything at all. Repentance is the first step in becoming who we are created to be, living a life that is full of meaning and hope and joy and peace. And repentance is really just turning away from sin and the ways of the world and turning to the life that God has desired for us from the start. See, when we repent, we make an intentional decision to believe all that the scriptures have said about Jesus, about God's plan of salvation for the world. Then we receive our mission to share that message of repentance and forgiveness of sins with all people. We take the side of truth. We claim the promises of God in the past have been fulfilled and point to the truth that God's promises of a glorious future and eternal life are already being fulfilled in us. We willingly become part of that plan, take our place in the kingdom of God that is already here, but not yet here in full. This gives us hope, and the Spirit gives us power to overcome in the battle for our souls and for the soul of the world that we live in. So when we feel that we're losing the battle, when we feel discouraged by the circumstances and situations we find ourselves in, when we look around and think that evil is winning the day, that the church will die, that no one will have faith, and that beautiful future is something that we'll never see, we can look up and picture our Lord and Savior, the one who lived, died, and was raised from the dead, and who ascended into heaven and now sits at the right hand of God the Father. Then we can know that God's promises are true. No matter what we see with our eyes or hear with our ears, Jesus lives in us by the power of the Holy Spirit. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, and his promise of the future is certain and sure. Take your place in God's salvation plan. We belong to him. The battle is already won, and we have the power of Christ living in us. And then go and share the good news, because this is our mission. And as we tell the world about Jesus, that future comes a little bit closer. Look up to heaven, and then see that future right here in your heart, because we belong to Christ. So let us be filled with great joy and, like his disciples, continually bless God with our lives as we embrace our mission to share the good news of Jesus Christ, knowing we belong to him and he is with us and interceding for us in heaven. Amen.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. And the story isn't good. the room. Failures never find a way in the followers in the room. Prodigals come home, the helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the father's in the room.
Everywhere we go. So, when you're feeling discouraged, look up. It's a good place to look. Love that song, Lauren Daigle, Look Up, Child. It's a good way to remember that Jesus is in heaven for us, interceding for us every moment, every day, fighting our battles for us. It's a good place to start. Look up. So go in the grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who sits at the right hand of God the Father for you. And then go and share the good news that that is for everyone. Let them know the love of God that we have in Christ, that peace is available, that hope will never die. Go in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Prodigals come home, the helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide, and the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the father's in the room. Miracle.